Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT. Bandwidth for All About Android is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This episode of All About Android is brought to you by Pearl Auto. Pearl Auto makes wireless rear view cameras for your car that fit around your license plate and sync with your smartphone. To get free 2-day shipping, go to pearlauto.com/AAA. And by CuriosityStream, a subscription streaming service that offers over 1,500 documentaries and nonfiction series from the world's best filmmakers. Get unlimited access starting at just $2.99 a month. And for our audience, the first 2 months are completely free if you sign up at CuriosityStream.com/TWiT and use the offer code TWiT. Hello and welcome to another episode of All About Android. This is episode 291, recorded on Tuesday, November 8th, 2016. We're your weekly source for the latest news, hardware, and apps for the Android faithful. I'm Jason Howell.
I'm Rob Richards.
And I'm Flo Ion, sort of distracted by my phone. Sorry
Why?
About that.
We have no idea what you're talking about, what that's like to be distracted by our phone. It's not like we don't live our lives on our phone.
Today of all days.
Right. I know. So. My phone was just like lighting up while you guys were introducing yourselves. Like people just, everyone.
Did we say the
today.
Wake word or something?
No, it's just it's a very busy day on the internet
today.
Yeah, there's
just weird things happening today on
very
the internet.
For
some reason,
things.
People are super excited. That's
or
why.
Super,
or super what?
In fear. I don't know.
Potentially. That's why, as our antidote for all the craziness
Precisely.
That's happening today, we brought on resident Canadian Daniel Bader from Android Central.
Canada, our home. Thank you for having me. So good to be back.
The only thing to shield us from the mayhem of today's election day is somebody from Canada. Thank you, Daniel.
I just offered all of America northern Manitoba in case you need a place to crash for the next 4 years.
Thank you.
Excellent.
Might just
You're
take
welcome.
You up on that. Although I did notice on Twitter that you, in your kind of lead up to this show, it seemed like you even admitted to today being kind of a stressful day. So this, I mean, the stress permeates across the border.
You know that trope that we care about America way more than America cares about us? It's
yes.
doubly true of American elections.
Wow.
They don't give a damn about our elections, even though we have the best looking leader in the free world.
Now we care. Because we saw how good
but,
looking.
Yeah, we care a lot about this. More
Dang,
than we should.
They look good up there. It was like France. Right. Nobody cared until Nicolas Sarkozy came on the scene.
He
was kind of cute. Mm-hmm. And he was married to Carla Bruni.
That's way more than I know about that scenario.
Anyway,
I think we've hit our max out of political talk.
Yeah, I think we're done with that. We've got a lot of Android related stuff, which is kind of what we do here. And by the way, Daniel, it's great to have you back. It's been a while. I'm super happy that you're with us today to talk about all
me
this.
Me too. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, of course. We're going to be talking about RCS messaging for Android. We're going to be talking about Google Home, which I have. Right here, although it's not mine. Do we want to see what's on somebody's calendar? No, let's not do that.
Sadly, it does not have essential oil diffusing. I know I keep making that joke.
It's not putting off an effervescence.
That's exactly what it looks like.
It really does.
It looks like a knockoff of the doTERRA.
I will give someone.
I'll look it up.
Someone on Twitter. I will give someone on Twitter credit. I forget who did it, but they tweeted at me a picture of an air freshener in the bathroom at an Outback, and they said they keep on saying, "Okay, Google, do it. Nothing's happening."
Yes. Yeah. Well, we've got one of those in the restroom here. And every time I go into the bathroom, I look at it and I'm like, it totally looks like a home. So, I mean, it's a repeated joke, but it's based in reality because we've all seen an air freshener that looks like this thing. Anyways, that's one of the things we'll talk about. We're going to talk about Daydream, Huawei Mate 9, Android Auto for phones, LastPass is free for all for the most part, and a whole lot more. Before we get into it, apparently Flo just put into the doc chat an image of the essential oil thing.
I'm grabbing it.
doTERRA.
It's called the kettle diffuser.
That's a little rounded. But yeah, I kind of see it.
See?
It's like the short version.
Anyway, this is not an ad for doTERRA. This is just a...
I just bought one.
Exactly what it reminds me of.
You just moved Daniel to buy one. Thanks a lot.
Well done.
It's not going to talk back to you, Daniel, at all, though.
No, it won't. But it will go...
It's all the night. Only Google Home that I can order in Canada, so that's fine.
All right, we're gonna have plenty of time today to talk about Google Home because I think we definitely have thoughts. But before that, Brian, it's time for the news.
It's election day here in the USA, but we cast our votes for the most important Android news.
It's true. It should be noted that we have a very important vote that takes place on this show every single week. Today's could be the most important vote you'll make.
I actually tried today.
What?
You're talking about the App Arena?
Yeah, of course I'm talking about I'm talking about the App Arena. There are plenty of things to vote today, but
well,
yes, the App Arena is the one
that's
close.
We have a vote, you know, what should Flo eat on the drive home?
It's true.
You know, should Ron go out and play?
Yep.
The answer, the vote is usually yes, Ron should go out to play.
And yes, always, Flo should eat on the drive home.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, hey, let's talk about Android stuff here. First and foremost here, Google is rolling out an update to SMS on Sprint. So it's kind of isolated right now, Sprint Android phones. But it's kind of been a long time coming. It's called RCS, Rich Communication Service. We've talked about it on the show in the past. It's a little kind of elusive, but essentially what it is, it's kind of an update to SMS that that brings, you know, new features, things like group chat, high-res photo support, read receipts. I think if you're typing, it shows on the other side, you know, you're typing in an entry, that sort of stuff. It appears within an updated Messenger app, Google's Messenger app, runs on Google's Jive RCS platform that Google acquired Jive back in September 2015. But it's only Sprint right now. So all new Sprint phones next year will have updated Messenger pre-installed so that they can get in on this action. 58 carriers are working on supporting RCS, but everybody's kind of got a different standard, apparently. Google really wants everybody to use its. Sprint is. AT&T and T-Mobile have their own versions, so they're not cross-compatible. So on one hand, yay. On another hand,
nay.
Here we are again. I don't know. What do you think about this, Daniel?
Oh, my God. So it just reminds me of HD voice all over again. Remember when T-Mobile and Verizon and AT&T started talking about how they were going to support HD voice and eventually voice over LTE? But even today, if you make an HD voice call on AT&T, it won't connect to a Verizon customer using that protocol. So you can't get that high definition voice call. It's the same thing here, right? It's ostensibly an open standard, but nobody implements it the same way. It's terrible. It makes me crazy.
I'm Daniel. I'm right there with you. It drives me nuts. I was having a conversation recently about the protocols that we all agreed upon and utilized to help the internet get to where it is. FTP, SMTP. HTTP. All of these were just standard protocols that were beautifully simple and elegant and were able for the internet to grow and become what it is today. And in fact, we still use them, you know, and this goes back to the whole with Allo coming out and WhatsApp and iOS, you know, with Apple messages or whatever it is. And it just drives me crazy that we blew messaging. That SMS is a standard that is last updated in 1986, I believe. It's outdated. It's old. It needs to be updated. And we need to agree on what that standard is so that everybody's operating on the same level playing field so that we can grow from here. And I hope that I had high hopes for RCS, but this super worries me if they can't get their act together on this and make it work across all platforms.
Why can't they get their act together?
Everybody wants the standard that everybody else follows.
It's competitive advantage, but yeah. The thing is that like you can proliferate and have growth by being on the same level. Not everything needs to be a competitive advantage. It drives me crazy.
Go, Daniel.
No, I was just gonna say, you know, Verizon is probably gonna be the biggest roadblock here because it has its own proprietary messaging format. Essentially, it has the advanced messaging that it pre-installs on every Droid, and you know, even it even snuck it in there on the Pixel,
which is why I didn't buy my Pixel from them.
And when you think about how much influence they have over, you know, regulatory bodies in the U.S., I mean, the only way this would ever get standardized is if the FCC stepped in and said, "Hell no, you're not going to roll out four versions of the same messaging format. You're not going to mess up HD voice because these are essential services. But until then, I mean, a competitive advantage is a competitive advantage, and there's no incentive for them to standardize it. What I find so interesting, though, is that there are formats like WebRTC on the video side that have sort of been adopted by so many different companies and agreed upon as the next best thing. And yet for this, it seems like if there's a business incentive to introduce a new standard or modify that standard, I mean, just look at USB-C charging, mm-hmm. right? Look at Quick Charge. You know, Qualcomm has messed up the USB-C spec, and everybody's agreeing that that's okay because it is basically a monopoly in the U.S. in terms of chips. But, you know, it's really not it's not adhering to the USB standard at all. So, you know, there's all of these examples of just companies messing up things that we agreed upon beforehand for their own benefit.
Well, yeah, and it reminds me of a couple of years ago when we were having all the fights over the video standards. You know, the H.264 spec, everybody was going to embrace that, but then there were licensing issues, and it's like, okay, what is our standard for encoding video, and what is our standard for messaging, and what is our standard for quick charging? It's the problem is that the idea of standards has gone out the window for years now, like nearly 10 years of no one adhering to any standards. And I don't think the FTC or the FCC or any of the governing bodies are going to get involved because they don't have the people under. They're reactionary. They're not proactive. And the days of a unified body like the W3C or you know, the folks looking over HTML and things like that are long gone. And that really worries me about the future of innovation.
Daniel, it's interesting that you bring up kind of standards around USB-C charging to kind of follow down this. Earlier today, I believe it was yesterday or today, there was a revision of the Android compatibility definition document. And, you know, so of course, everybody's kind of poring over that. And one of the things to come out of this is that in Android 7.0, Google is basically saying that soon it will require OEMs to basically stop altering the USB-C charging standards and be closer to the specs, which makes me kind of wonder what that means for Qualcomm's quick charging and others. But man, as a user, I would really love that because I'd love for there to be just like one standard. I feel like at this point, I don't know how to quick charge my phones. Now, mind you, I'm in a very isolated case. I've had a million phones, so I've got a million different chargers everywhere. And but that charger doesn't quick charge this phone, and it's just a pain in the butt. It would be nice to have it all in one even playing field. Yeah, so, I mean, I think also kind of the punchline here is that Project Fi is also not compatible with RCS, even though that's,
of course.
Even though that's Google's thing.
It's the classic Google one hand, the left hand not talking to the right hand right there. Oh,
yeah,
man.
So, I mean, and even classic. Though part of Project Fi is Sprint, but, you know, I guess because it's not the full, you know, the full spectrum of the two different services that it jumps between, I guess that's too much of a challenge.
I just wonder if Google would have teamed up with a bigger carrier to unload this, if this would have, I don't know, maybe made a bigger splash.
Well, no, I think they strategically put it on Sprint so they can control the population of phones it's on. I don't think you want to roll it out with T-Mobile or Verizon with such a large population
That's
of
true.
Phones on their network.
That's true.
You know, like this is truly a test case. And so like Sprint, yeah, Sprint made sense. You know, like I'm not surprised it's on Sprint at all. In fact, if Google was unified in their thinking, they probably would have rolled it out to Project Fi first because that's probably even the smallest grouping.
Right.
But actually, there's now that makes sense because it wouldn't work on Project Fi because Project Fi will hop network.
Yep.
Yeah,
and that's what I mean.
You don't want it to be working on Sprint but then not working on T-Mobile or Verizon. Yeah, see, there you go.
Exactly. Oh. I don't know if Google would have necessarily been like, nah, don't want to do this with Verizon. There's too many users. I think if they could have got that deal,
they
would have done it.
Yeah.
But I just wonder from a marketing standpoint.
Yeah.
I don't know. Mm-hmm. It's all a very, you know, we're talking about it and I'm like, I am just going to wait a little bit longer until some people figure their stuff out with RCS.
I mean, and I think the challenge to what you were talking about, Dan, as far as like having some sort of like entity step in and say, no, actually we require everybody to be on the same page here. Same with HD voice. Is it an essential service? You know what I mean? Like, people can still make calls in the traditional way. In the case of SMS, people can still send messages and everything. This is just an improvement. So I don't know. I mean, is there a point at which they're like, well, actually, this is essential that we you know, solidify this between all players, because there's an alternative that people already have access to. I don't know if that has any sort of influence over it.
Well, but it's cross-platform too, right? So
yeah. It's independent of operating system.
Think about in 10 years when every carrier in the U.S. has deprecated their 3G networks. CDMA is not a thing anymore.
Yeah.
Everybody's going to be on LTE all the time. So when you look at it from that perspective, interoperability is going to be an essential service.
For sure.
And when you know, when you really get technical about it, they will be forced by some, you know, market, by some market force to really figure out how to work together. It's just a matter of them pulling enough teeth so that they can incentivize enough customers to switch. Mm-hmm. And then at some point, they're all going to throw up their hands and say, okay, fine, we just have to make these deals. But it's going to be at the last possible second. And that's what's so frustrating about this.
Mm-hmm. And the consumer loses. The end user pays the price, and that's what pisses me off about this.
Mm-hmm. But I mean, look, Ron. Like, I don't want to like extend this too much, but think about the potential impact of this across the Android ecosystem. I mean, this could potentially, if implemented correctly, be iMessage for all Android users across every U.S. carrier and eventually the world. And instead, they're fragmenting this potentially very powerful new feature. And then we have companies like Facebook that are growing WhatsApp to 2 billion users and Facebook Messenger to 1.5 billion users. And there are so many people in the world who would benefit from this open platform, but instead they're moving to more closed platforms like those owned by huge billion, you know, public companies that are there to make money off you. And you think, okay, well, you know, your carrier's trying to make money off you. The service providers on which you rely on your carrier service are trying to make money off you. And at some point, you just have to accept that one is going to leech more from you than the other, right? It's like, you, as you said, you lose. It's just a matter of who you lose more to.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, I think it's
super cynical, but I mean, tonight seems like that kind of night.
Yeah, it does.
But it's in the air.
I just think it's fascinating to see the cycle that we've gone as users. If you look at where we were 25 years ago, we were in a environment of walled gardens. You connected via Prodigy or CompuServe or AOL, and then we had this explosion of freedom and explosion of commonality and explosion of everybody on the same platforms. Everyone was on email, and this is great. Mm-hmm. And, you know, walled gardens were still there, but they weren't as prevalent. And we're moving rapidly towards sealing ourselves up in walled gardens again. Whether it's an Apple walled garden or a Facebook walled garden or whomever, you know, whichever platform you or Google's walled garden, and that's when innovation gets stifled, and that's when the best stuff doesn't happen. And so I don't want to see that happen. And I know messaging is something I get really fired up about this, but I've talked about it before in the past. It drives me crazy that you got to think, how do I talk to this person? Mm-hmm. I look at my phone and I think of the 7 different ways I message somebody. Is it on Slack? Is it on WhatsApp? Is it on SMS? It's maddening. It's maddening. So I just want to live in Star Trek where you did a little thing and they beep and then you talk to them. So anyway, but anyway, moving on. So going from very passionate messaging topic to numbers, market share numbers, Strategy Analytics has a new report that nearly 9 out of 10 smartphones shipped last quarter were running Android. That's 375 million shipped, 87.5% of the population running Android, 45.5 million iPhone shipped, down 5.2%. And it's the focus on developing markets with inexpensive phones that is helping that shift. So right now, Android is the dominant platform, whether people want to, people want to accept it or not. Android rules all. Is that a good thing? That's the question I'm curious about. Daniel, what do you think?
I mean, it's a great thing
for us.
it's the best possible scenario for the proliferation of inexpensive mobile computing, right? If you think about how many people have access to a super powerful phone in developing markets that wouldn't otherwise have the millions of great apps. And, you know, even though those are, you know, you could have Google Play as a walled garden, you could have whatever, you know, is going on in China with its million different app stores. Some amazing innovations happening in India, but ultimately they're all running Android. And that's great, because it's always going to be an open concept, you know, as closed as the Pixel may be. And we could have, and I'm, you know, you guys have had this conversation many times and all that stuff. But yeah, I mean, it's awesome. The problem is that nobody's making any damn money in the Android space. And the market share could be 100%, but if nobody's making a cent from it, then in some case, you know, in some ways, Apple's still kind of winning. Right. So
they do have a lot of cash, literal cash.
What do you guys say about that? Because, like, you know, there's always this argument about profit versus market share.
Right.
I mean, you would think that with market share comes profit. I mean, that's the equation. But not with $100, $150 Android phones versus the $700 iPhone, I could see that. But again, you know, like, we're looking at just the microcosm of the United States, where iOS is a big competition. It could be argued that iOS isn't even a blink in Android's eye when you look at the world.
Oh,
so,
yeah. I mean, you expand it outside of the U.S. and it's so a much lot money. Different story.
Yeah.
So. Super expensive.
Well, that's what I think that's exactly the point. It's like in the U.S. it seems a lot more competitive
because we're a first world country.
In a lot of other places, I mean, it's like, you know, the iPhone is like a Porsche, let's say. You know what I mean? It's like a high end,
which really should negate the need for all those special edition Porsche Chinese smartphones. But for some
we'll
reason,
talk
they
about
keep
that.
Putting them out. I don't understand.
We'll talk
why.
About that. What I was kind of curious about is how this kind of you know, like 90% of all smartphones shipped, how that affects innovation, let's say. You know, the kind of point that I came up with is that Microsoft really dominated in the 90s, right? And innovation, as you know, many would say, kind of slowed down at about that time. When you've got someone that commands so much power over a certain thing, is there as much reason to innovate rapidly? Do you think that pressure still sits on Google, on Alphabet's shoulders?
No.
Yeah.
I mean,
yes.
Sorry,
I do. Yes.
Okay. But it's not.
Yeah,
sorry.
Yeah, absolutely.
I was not because connecting my thoughts.
The comparison you're making there is Microsoft dominating with an operating system on a desktop market that was hindered by the state of Moore's Law and the state of where hardware was at the time and graphic processors and stuff like that. It's a completely different universe now in terms of technology and the innovation. You might be right. The innovation might slow on the operating system side, although it's interesting that the innovation on iOS, everybody compares to, it's iOS is becoming more and more Android-like. So it could be said that they spent all that time innovating there, but now the innovation's coming on devices and hardware and phones and things like that. So I think it's, you know, I mean, yeah, you're right. Market penetration could lead to stagnancy, but in this case, I don't think it is, just because this the area we live in now is so dynamic. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I could be wrong, but you know, that's my thought.
I just think what I meant to say earlier, I was trying to connect some thoughts in my brain, but then I spoke too soon. I just feel like the number of Android smartphones that exist is kind of worrisome for the Android platform as a whole, which is a whole nother discussion.
You mean the amount of variance and all that?
Yeah,
kind of
the
stuff?
Amount of variance and everything. And I think we are already starting to see like the peak of, we already kind of saw the peak of innovation, and I feel like we're going to be stagnant for a little bit.
No, the next phase of innovation is bezel-less phones.
But
haven't you heard?
I don't find that to be entirely, I mean, maybe call me whatever.
I know.
I don't really,
but everybody's saying it's the future.
Cynical. I mean,
innovative. All right, let's do an email.
Yeah, let's do an email. So this email comes from Mike. Mike asks, I find myself doing most of my internet searching in the incognito mode of Chrome. It's not that I have anything to hide, but rather to keep related material from appearing in my Google Now feed. I totally agree about that. I'd like to limit those stories to information I want to know about daily, not things related to a one-time search. On my Windows computer, I've been able to make a Chrome link on my desktop to automatically open in incognito mode, but I was wondering if there is a way to do this on Android. And the good news, Mike, is that there is. So follow along very simply. Open the default browser that you have, which is Chrome. Open a new incognito tab, go to settings, and then tap on general. And under set homepage, set the current incognito homepage. And from now on, when you launch it up,
Woohoo! You get your wish.
And incognito.
And that solves that problem. But the problem that he's raising, I've run into as well, which is the one-off search. Google then thinks it's something you're obsessed with. And you can go into Google now and say, don't include this topic. I've done that before on things.
Yeah,
you know,
but
like
it's
I've,
too many clicks.
You know,
and if you're like on
Agreed. No, but I think this is a bigger problem that Google hasn't solved yet that we're seeing as we're seeing the AI and the assistant get more involved. Just because I search for fried chicken places in, you know, Dubuque, Iowa, I don't even know if Dubuque is in Iowa, but in Des Moines, Iowa, doesn't mean that I live in Iowa and I want to know all about Iowa. You know what I mean? Like, you know, just because, you know, if you might be, you know, Flo or Daniel, you might be writing an article about a specific subject and you search that person once, you then run the risk of getting a Google Now card every time that person comes up in the news. Yeah. And this is
like
something that Google needs to solve.
Like serial killers and murderers and other criminals that I may be curious about. I just want to read the case. I don't need Google to keep reminding me that I did that one time at 1 a.m.
There was that one time I searched for Justin Bieber and then I continued to get Justin Bieber stuff. And I can't even tell you why I searched for Justin Bieber.
That's unfortunate considering
I guarantee you it wasn't a good idea. I know that already.
She's always doing bad things, and there's always like...
Yeah, it was probably something like
Justin
that.
Who is Justin Bieber so don't, offended today?
Don't make the same Bieber mistake that I made.
In my defense, Dubuque is a city in Iowa, okay. So I was right the first time. So, whew, okay.
How did they vote? No, I'm joking.
No. hey, let's take a break, and thanks, sponsor of this episode. That is Pearl Auto. Pearl Auto makes a set of wireless rear view cameras that fit around your license plate and sync with your smartphone so that you can drive more safely. If your car doesn't have a rear view camera already installed, this is a great way to kind of retrofit it, essentially. Soon, rear view cameras will be mandatory on all new cars. Pearl Auto allows you to immediately retrofit any car to let you drive just as safely without having to buy a brand new car. Pearl Auto is quick and easy to install. You just install the camera frame around your license plate using a simple screwdriver. You plug in the car adapter to your onboard diagnostic port. That's the OBD port underneath the dash. Mount your phone on your dashboard or your vent. Download the Pearl app. They've got an app for Android or iOS, of course, and it's ready to use. You're going to drive safer and with confidence. Two HD cameras send audio and visual alerts to your phone to warn you of obstacles that might be in your way. You can switch between normal and wide-angle views and even see around corners. It works day or night. It's versatile. Pearl Auto works on any car. The camera frame is solar powered, so it stays charged all on its own. That's awesome. It uses Bluetooth wireless technology to sync cameras to your phone. The Pearl app will automatically update to add additional features, of course, and just really cool technology. Tony, our supervising producer here, installed the Pearl Auto in less than 10 minutes, and it's just a really neat setup. I mean, it literally brings that technology to your vehicle. You might not have had it before. Looks slick. And yeah, it's just awesome. As someone who owns a smaller car, Tony actually found it super useful when backing up between two SUVs, for example, while trying to get to back out in rainy weather. He also loved the magnetic vent mount with its pivot ball joint. It kind of makes it easy to mount. If you can install a license plate frame, you can install the Pearl. Pearl Auto has a special offer just for listeners of this show to get free 2-day shipping. Go to pearlauto.com/AAA. That's going to get that to you even quicker. That's pearlauto.com/AAA. We thank Pearl Auto for their support of All About Android. All right. We've got some hardware to talk about. Let's get to it. We do. All right, Ron.
It was Christmas in November.
Was it?
I got home on Friday, and I had the little blinking light that I had a package waiting downstairs, and I was like, I'm not expecting a package. It's November 5th.
I know.
I'm not expecting anything till November 8th. And so I marched downstairs, and I saw there was a little package from Google, ironically also from a depot in Iowa, I believe. I keep going back to Iowa tonight. And I ran upstairs and opened up my Google Home, and the moment I've been waiting for since the presentation, since Google I.O. back in May or June, whenever it was. So Google's Home device, Google Home shipped. It's in there. It is. Jason, you got it in your hand. It's here in my apartment. I assume we've all played with it. Daniel, you can't because you're in Canada, right?
I haven't even seen one.
Wow, there you go.
All right. Have you seen his prime minister? I mean,
no. Okay, so for Daniel and our audience's benefit, Jason, Flo, myself, I want to just quickly go around in the limited time we've had it. Thumbs up or thumbs down, Jason?
Oh man, that's well. I mean, I'd say I've had it very limited, but I would say thumbs up.
Flo.
I have no. My cat ran away when I was going to set it up today, and I ended up.
That sounds like a lovely excuse. I give it a huge thumbs up.
You give it a huge thumbs up.
A huge thumbs up. I love this device. Now,
I've had it since Friday, and I haven't set it up. By the way,
oh my goodness,
it's just sitting in a box in my house.
Shows the dedication you've got to Google. But seriously, I was so excited to hook it up. I don't have an Amazon Echo. I've been holding out for a Google device. You know, we had rumors earlier this year that this was coming. So I'm like, all right, I'm not gonna plunk down the $200 or whatever it is for Amazon because I'm tied into the Google environment. My experience has been I plugged it in. I've been using it. My girlfriend's been using it. I think the dog has been using it. I'm not sure. But it's been great. I mean, it's a little quirky in places. But not overall. I mean, if I had to write a review of it, I would say that it's a device that out of the gate is strong with a lot of potential, and I'm excited to see what comes to it. I was really the music integration has been awesome. Jason, do you agree? I mean, did you have a chance to play the speaker?
Yeah, that's my favorite feature so far. Yep. It's actually so I put mine in the kitchen where we have had a Bose sound dock with a Chromecast audio plugged into it. And I'm very happy to have this in there. The sound quality isn't quite as awesome as the Bose sound dock because the Bose is really awesome.
Yeah.
It's a Bose. But it's totally sufficient, totally doable, loud enough, just not as kind of clear in some of the frequencies.
Yeah, I have noticed it's funny because I was trying to do a comparison because I've got a pair of crappy $15 desktop speakers currently right now because my good speakers are still in storage. But and then I've also got a Jawbone Jambox that I've been using for music. And I was trying to do a comparison between the three, and oddly enough, the Jambox has got better bass or better presence. Mm-hmm. But the Google Home is loud, and it's totally taken over. Like I don't even use my desktop speakers anymore. I've got Google Play Music in the browser, casting directly to the Google Home speaker, so I don't even need to use Google Home to do it.
Yeah.
But working with the Google Home Assistant has been super easy. I mean, just saying, you know, I don't want to say that the catchword because I forgot to turn my mic off. But like, I could just say, you know, play this album and it plays it up. I say play this artist and it plays. Every song is a song I want to hear. It's not going like deep. Like they're doing something with the like. Of course, I'm connected to Google Play Music. You could connect it to Spotify. You could connect it to Pandora. I don't know what the results are there, but it seems to be playing the songs you want to hear as opposed to some random deep cut. It plays the radio function in Google Play Music. I can say play this thing and go from there. The news integration has been great. Just waking up in the morning and saying blank Google. You know, what's going on today, and then having it, you know, tell me the weather, tell me, I'll get to the calendar stuff, but then go right into NPR news. That's really cool. Yeah. I was really surprised and delighted to see out of the gate integration with Uber, where I can just say, Google, call me an Uber, and it does it, and it's connected to my account. I don't need to take my phone out at all. I think that's awesome. Wow. And if that's the potential of what to come with other integrations, like that could be super, super cool.
Does it let you know when the Uber is there?
I actually haven't gone all the way through of getting one yet. I haven't had to, but I connected the account. I confirmed that it did it, and then I quickly canceled. So I still need to play with that. But it's just been really the test for me was, will my girlfriend, who also lives here, who isn't a Google, you know, she has an iPhone and all that sort of stuff, will she use it when I'm not around? And she totally was. She was playing music on it, checking weather, doing the news, just talking to it, and never, you know, like, and I said, tell me if you get stuck or if it's not giving the results you need. And she's like, no, every time it gave me back an answer. Getting real tired of the, I don't have an answer for that. I'm working on, my team's getting me better every day. Like that, the excuse answer that Google Home gives you. Mm-hmm. But it's been great. I mean, like the hit or miss ratio has been, it's been way more hit than miss in terms of the voice recognition and talking to it. No problem between either of our voices. But of course we like immediately she's like, how can I get it to see my calendar? And I was like, yeah, that's the problem.
Uh-huh.
So, fun fact, we can't do that yet. Sorry. Yeah,
that's such a big downside for this. Hopefully they figure that out and get that working smoothly sometime soon.
So we have ours in the kitchen, right? And so if I use the wake word and I have my phone on me, obviously it wakes on the phone, but it sends the command to the home, probably because the phone is closer to me than the home is. That's why it wakes up there. But then when I'm upstairs, so what that does is that tells me like, oh, so I can use my phone as a remote, because that's how it seems like, right? So then I'm upstairs. Yeah. I'm like, I want to play this song. I want to play the Beatles downstairs because my girls were in the kitchen. I wanted to surprise them and like, you know, from upstairs, like cue up a song and play it. So I tried to use my phone to do that, and it doesn't let you do that. I feel like it should. I feel like your brain is already programmed to do that because it does that when you're down there. Why can't it do it elsewhere?
Did you try doing it from the home app, or did you try just doing it from the wake word?
I tried doing it from Assistant, which is
okay. Yeah,
you know what I mean.
I believe if you open up the home app, you can do you can control it via the app.
Yeah.
And do that, but it's you're not talking to it. I did find it funny that so I've got it here in the living room, you know, living room kitchen, you know, the New York apartment. But my tablet is in the bedroom. And I hear the tablet reacting when I say the wake word as well. So I was like, oh, interesting. Let me look at that. So I grabbed I did something with the Google Home. Then I went and grabbed the tablet and I saw that the tablet had the little message saying, being answered on another device,
right.
on the display, which I was like, oh, so they're talking somehow. It's yeah. So,
yeah, no, they're definitely, tossing it back and forth. So that's nice. What else is there? Wake word. You can use hey if you don't want to wake up your phone, and that's going to work just on that device. Let's see here. So Leo said one of his favorite features is when you set a timer, you can set a timer for bacon or set a timer for pancakes or whatever. That way, when the timer is up, it tells you what that timer was for. That way, if you set multiple timers, it's not just like, timer's going off. What was that for? I don't know. It actually lets you know what it's associated with.
Or you could order takeout.
That actually...
Can't you order takeout with it?
I don't know.
I haven't
done that yet. We'll have to look
How would you
that.
Order takeout with it?
Well, you can order Domino's from the Amazon Echo. Why can't you
order...
I don't know. Maybe you can.
I mean, can't because you like Grubhub or
isn't
something?
Isn't that part of the API, though?
It might be, yeah.
Eventually, yeah. I don't see any takeout integrations yet, but... I'm trying to bring this up
as a point that it's like
it's featureless.
Remember,
cool.
Compared.
I get to control music with it, but like, okay.
You want
to?
Well,
I want to do more.
Well, hang on. What's cool was that I said so. We were making breakfast. So we were making brunch over the weekend, and I was like, oh, I want to make French toast. And so I said, just as a joke, I said, okay, Google had. Oh, I didn't get it. Okay, I said, wake word. How do you make French toast? And it came back and started spitting out a French toast recipe. And it did that for about a minute. And then it said, open up your home app to see the full recipe that I just gave you. And I opened up the home app and there's the link to the recipe that it read to, which I thought was
okay. Oprah? It was Oprah.
Okay, let's just talk about that for a second, because that's really interesting, because that's likely the top Google search result, which means that there is going to be so much SEO, there's going to be a whole new war around that top Google search result. We're talking about, you know, wanting to get on the first page of Google search results and how important that is for sites. Now, that top result could mean boom or bust for a particular company or a particular website. Yeah. And, you know, that's pretty extreme. But, like, think about how important that Oprah.com recipe would be over, you know, a Vanity Fair or a... you know, Good Housekeeping or whatever. And like, that's so interesting to me that there's going to be this voice search battleground that is going to probably be even more important than what we find on our phones today, like as a text-based input.
Yep. No, that's a great point, because it's going to be, you know, if I'm a content creator, I want to make sure that if the Google Assistant is giving you one result as opposed to a page of 10, like we've gotten from Google Search Engine, you're going to want to do everything in your power to make that be your result, which I think is really interesting.
But anywhere along the line on Google Home, is it telling you this came from such and such place, or is it just here's information?
I'm trying to go back to the link, and unfortunately it's gone. I could do it right now. But no,
yeah,
I don't want
to do it right now.
Okay, Google.
Your pressure.
How do I make French toast?
We can hardly hear it.
You can, yeah, hang on.
Yeah.
Okay, Google, turn up the volume. Okay, Google, max volume. Okay, Google, how do you make French toast?
Sorry to everyone's phones.
According to McCormick, Beebeg, vanilla, and cinnamon in shallow dish.
According to McCormick. Blah, blah, blah.
Okay, Google, stop.
Okay, so according to, so it does get credit there.
So
right
according
at the top.
To the people who make spices, this is how you make French toast with our spices. Right.
Oh, yeah. That's bad. That's another good point, right? At what point does Google sell sponsored posts to those first results?
You have kids in the house. Mom, are we using McCormick cinnamon? I'm just saying.
Oh, that's interesting.
But their cinnamon's really, really good.
Or whatever, nutmeg.
Yeah,
you
nutmeg.
You put nutmeg in French toast.
Here's one go.
Oh, go for it, Jason. Go.
I haven't tried this.
All right, do it.
But let's try it here. And I'm sorry for everyone. Let's see, did I unmute it? Okay, Google. Did I go away, phone?
Wrong device.
Dang it. Here.
There we go.
Okay, so now it's on. Okay. Okay, Google. Let's play Mad Libs.
Oh yeah, this is cool.
I'll pretend to go get a pencil.
Oh, that's so the music that plays when you go to pretend to get a pencil.
Huh. Okay.
This is Mad Libs. The world's greatest word game.
Okay, we don't actually have to play it, but I just I wanted to prove
I thought
that
the world's greatest word game was Wheel of Fortune.
Okay, Google, stop. Or I could just tap
it's
on
Scrabble.
Mad Libs was cool. The crystal ball thing was cool. There's a bunch of little games and stuff that are neat.
Yeah.
One important thing I want to note, though, is that in the settings of Google Assistant within Google Home, there's a check mark for personal results. And it says allow Google Home to read out your personal info like calendar and flights, display your photos on TV, and help you with tasks like reservation and purchases. You can turn that off if you're concerned about other people in your household getting access to your stuff. It's just a one-tap turn off, which I thought was smart because that a lot of people probably don't want that stuff to be just broadcast to the entire house.
Yeah, nice. And like, you know, our house is definitely like I've got, you know, three other people in the house. And once my kids figure out how to control this thing, they're going to be getting in and probably mucking it up. Yeah. So I'm probably going to remove all that stuff and just have it be, you know, music, web search, Mad Libs.
Yeah, the other neat thing, I know we're going long here, and I'm sorry, but the other neat thing here is that you within the Google Assistant, there's a lot of customization. Not only do you choose what music platform you want, Google Play Music, Spotify, or Pandora, but under News, you can choose, you can choose and then rank the order that you want news to come from. So there's NPR, Fox, NPR Technology, Bloomberg, ESPN, and you can customize this. You can add and remove news sources. So you're getting some control over what you're actually getting. And then finally, the other thing that worked seamlessly was that when I was making French toast, I needed syrup. And I just said, Google, add syrup to my shopping list. And it created a shopping list in Google Keep and immediately synced it. So that's pretty cool.
Why can't you do, okay, Google, order me syrup through Instacart or through Safeway.com and then have it delivered?
They're not there yet.
I know, but this
is
what
it just
I
launched.
Want.
But it just
it's
launched.
Coming.
That's why.
It's coming.
That's why, that's why I said this is a device with potential. So
lots and lots of potential that I can only dream about right now.
Yeah. Yep.
What's that, Daniel?
Daniel Echo started out being so bad. Like, it was useless. Nobody knew why you would want to buy one. And now it's basically an essential tool.
Mm-hmm. I look to the day that I wake up in the morning or whatever. Like, I'm having a busy, crazy week. And all of a sudden, like, my tooth starts aching. And I go, oh, man, when's the last time I had a cleaning? And so I just want to go, you know, okay, so. When was the last time I had my teeth cleaned? And then it'd be like, you went to have your teeth cleaned in May, blah, blah, blah. And like, or whatever. Like, it looks at my calendar and it sees like the entry where I went to go get, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's what I'm really looking forward to.
Flo, we got to start somewhere.
I know. I'm just telling you my wishes. Yeah. This is what I wish, because I don't think I'm going to, I bought it to have it. I don't know. We'll see. I'll set it up this week and we'll see how much I get into the groove of it because, I mean,
really
Google Now is so a central part of my life.
Yeah. I do think that in my short time with it, like what I've wondered is does it have value to have an appliance that does what my phone does in my pocket? And in my short time with it, I feel like, yes, absolutely.
Yes.
That use case proved itself in a very short amount of time. Where I was like, I was doing dishes. Like it was the stereotypical like example.
I'm doing my makeup and I have a question. I was doing dishes and
I was able to talk to it and get it to do things. And I was like, that's really cool.
Yeah, because sometimes I can't get my phone to listen.
Yeah.
A couple of quick things, then we'll wrap it up. And Jason, I totally agree with you. Being able to just ask it questions and get results and quick answers, I don't even need to take my phone out of the pocket or off the charger or whatever. That's great. In the chat room, Marsworm says that he asked about French toast and got the Pioneer Woman recipe, not McCormick, which I think is interesting.
Okay.
Region-specific search.
Or it's just a carousel of different who knows? Options.
Or maybe it's how I asked it versus how he asked it. Who knows?
Yeah, maybe.
Then finally, the immediate play to music and things like that also work for podcasts. If you just say play All About Android, it just starts playing the latest episode, which is cool. So if you're in a podcast that I haven't run into a show that it wasn't able to find. So.
Nice. Yeah. Well, and I mean, that's all integrated in Play Music anyways, so that's probably pretty easy for it to do.
I just want the future now.
Don't we all? Don't we all just want the future now?
I'm just impatient.
Speaking of the future now, what about wearing the future on your face? No, not Google Glass. That's the past. Talking about Google Daydream View.
Did you just make that up?
What?
Did you just make that whole thing up, that whole riff? That was pretty good.
Thanks.
That was good.
I'll go ahead and pop the collar for that. Oh, I can't. Dang it, it doesn't pop. Google Daydream View, it's stuck. It's stuck back there. I got to play around with it a little bit. I was at a VRDC last week, and Google was set up shop, although they did not let me bring a film crew in to do this.
I like this rogue.
So this was totally across the room. I didn't know it was happening. All I knew is that I got 5 minutes with Google Daydream View to play around with it, and our crew was able to get it on the sly, get the footage. But I will say that when I stepped up there, the very first thing that the Google representative said was, "I'm sorry, it's a little wet because it's fabric, right?" And I guess from all the people that were wearing it, it was squishy. It was squishy, you guys. Probably the grossest experience I've had with the VR yet.
Physically retching.
Oh, that's so gross.
That's an issue. That's an issue. This is not for mass market. This is for personal.
Well, no,
use.
But the thing is,
it's for personal.
The thing is, how often are you passing around your VR visor? I mean, I feel that's like this is mine.
Use Gear VR as a giant, theme parks because those are easy to clean off.
There is something about VR that people want to get the share, get the experience that have never done it before. So it's like, oh, well, I've got it. So here you go.
But it's like getting carpet in your house, Jason. If you have a bunch of dogs and cats. Maybe I should be careful with this, but you have a lot of carpet. It gets really nasty, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like I just think about
don't,
that.
Don't rub that carpet on your face, especially not if it's sweaty carpet.
I'm just trying to think. You have to think about this stuff when you're building things that you're putting on people's faces. I'm just saying.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, maybe this is extreme circumstances.
I'm not sure.
There
sharing.
Were a lot
I'm
of people that really wanted
daydream.
To like,
I'm not sharing
wear that
my Daydream VR. I'm sorry. It's mine and mine only then.
Fair enough. Fair enough. So it releases in a couple of days. So everyone can have a wet, sticky VR
viewer. Did you get
your
promo code yet?
No.
I didn't get mine either.
No, I think they're waiting until the 30 days is up so that you get beyond the return window is what I understand.
I guess it's fair.
But I did get to play the J.K. Rowling's
neat.
A fantastic Beasts or whatever.
The Harry Potter thing.
The Harry Potter, esque. Thing where the Daydream controller is your wand and everything.
Same world,
and that was really cool. Is it the same world? I'm very clear.
I mean, I'm
when
assuming it is.
Potter.
Yes, it is. It's earlier. It's pre. I hate it all, but yes, it's like a prequel-y of type thing. Why are we talking about this? It was a cool, Jason. Was it cool? Does it work? Is it neat? Would you buy one?
Well, it was definitely germy.
Yeah, I mean, that's a little bit of an asterisk to consider when you're thinking about which VR viewer to get. But I do like the controller. I think the controller is really the selling point.
I'm excited for that.
That and the ease of use. It was very easy to drop a phone right in there and, you plop it in and there's four little dots on the viewer that kind of send a signal to the phone as far as where the phone dropped in at so that it's always centered.
Love that.
So you don't have to fiddle it around to get it right just centered. Those dots indicate to the phone where you dropped it. You get a fully centered focus.
So it doesn't feel like the sort of mechanical, like the Gear VR.
Gear
Sometimes
VR is
feels,
very fumbly
like,
compared to this. Yeah. This is just kind of like doop.
So this really redefined the VR experience for phones. You know, if Gear VR felt clunky and this felt easy, like this is improvement. It's advancement.
I think it's better in the sense that Gear VR, you know, has the controls on the side, and that's always a little weird, like to have it in your hand, and you get the motion control. You know what I mean?
Go like an Oculus.
Yeah. I mean, no, it's way better in that.
Yeah, I don't like the side because I'm like, what am I touching? Yeah,
it's basically just a touchpad and swipe thing. This is like, it's hand controls, you know, so.
I can't wait to paint.
Yeah.
Virtually.
Well, you'll be able to do tilt brush pretty much at launch from what I understand.
Paint everything.
Very cool. Hey, Daniel, real quick here. Huawei had some announcements. You wrote up about the Mate 9. Are you impressed? What's the deal with the Mate 9?
Yeah, so I think it's probably going to be one of the best big phones of the year. Like, it's so weird when the Note was coming of age, I guess, in the 2012, 2013 era, everybody thought phones would just get bigger indefinitely. Like, it would go to 6 inches and we get used to 6.5. And then eventually we just, that photo of like, Phil holding up a tablet to his face would just be like the reality. But it's interesting that we've sort of realized our folly and come back a little bit and standardized on 5 to 5.5 is probably the sweet spot. So this is a big phone, but Huawei's done some really good things. It's not like Xiaomi Mi Mix levels of no bezel, but it's pretty damn close. It's definitely the most compact 5.9-inch phone I've used. They are saying that the software is pretty pre-production, so we have some time yet to figure out whether EMUI 5 is actually a dumpster fire. Right now, it's a little dumpster fiery. I mean, it's smoking. For example, somehow Huawei always seems to screw up notifications with EMUI 4.1 if you've ever used the Honor 8. The notification shade is just it's a piece of garbage.
I completely agree.
That like literally breaks things. This is not so bad, but it's pretty bad. Like, instead of showing you the little icons for the apps that you've been notified for, it just shows you a number. And if you have more than 9, it just says 9+. Like, think about that for a second. Who decided that? What moron in the design department decided that they should just show you a number instead of the little icons?
You don't need to see
it. It's nonsensical. It's bizarre. Anyway, so I don't know. I just find it. But for the most part, this phone is super fast. It's really nice for a 1080p screen. It looks really sharp. The jury's still out on the camera. The camera is not impressive to me for something that has the specs and the you know, it's got a dual sensor. It's got a dual sensor design. It's got the pedigree to have, you know, some really good low light shots. But so far, what I've seen has been fairly unimpressive. Hmm. Everything else, though, is in good shape. So I'm holding out my final verdict until we get final software in a couple weeks. But right now, I'm going to give it a kind of a lukewarm 2 thumbs up.
Yeah, I feel like with Huawei repeatedly, like it's great hardware. And the software.
And Honor.
What's that? Yeah.
And Honor.
Yeah.
Because I really like the Honor 8.
I group them into the same category. Yeah. Great hardware. Software always leaves something to be desired.
Yeah.
Thankfully, you can replace a lot of that. Not all of it. Like when it comes to notifications.
But the notifications.
I know.
That's the big thing.
Let's get some replaceable notifications on Android someday. I would love to see that.
That would be nice.
Yeah, Roshi,
that would
be really nice. Please.
Yeah. Make that happen. Cool. And then, of course, we've got a Porsche version of the design Mate 9.
Oh. And I'm getting that tomorrow. I'm so excited.
Are you?
Oh, yeah. I'm getting it in the mail. It's supposed to be like super, the box is supposed to be super swanky. And I'm that's actually what I'm most excited about.
You should do an unboxing tomorrow. I'm very curious to see this packaging. And
unboxing the crap out of this thing.
If you got a $1,500 phone that has Porsche on the label, you got to unbox that for sure.
Yeah. Oh, for sure.
Cool. Everybody look forward to that. Obviously, AndroidCentral.com.
Excellent. All right. Well, let's thank a sponsor before we move on with the show. We want to thank CuriosityStream for sponsoring this episode of All About Android. And if you haven't heard about CuriosityStream yet, CuriosityStream is the world's first ad-free nonfiction streaming service founded by John Hendricks, the founder of Discovery Channel. With over 1,500 titles, 600 hours of content, and over 50 hours of 4K content, CuriosityStream is the place to go for all your favorite nonfiction stuff to watch, documentaries, specials on science, technology, all this great stuff. It's all there. It's available in 196 countries worldwide and on all the platforms that you'd be looking for. They've got a web app. They're on Roku. They've got an Android app, iOS, Chromecast, Amazon Fire, Amazon Kindle, Apple TV. With a huge variety of science technology content, plus nature, history, and many more topics. And in addition to all those great documentaries, they have interviews and lectures. You can find such great stuff on CuriosityStream, like Stephen Hawking's Favorite Places, which is a brand new exclusive documentary in which the genius Stephen Hawking pilots a fantastical CGI spaceship across the universe, making stops at Saturn and many of his favorite destinations. How could you not want to watch that? They've also got a great show called Digits, which is a groundbreaking three-part series hosted by Derek Muller, the creator of YouTube science channel Veritasium, which explores online safety and security. The series features never-before-seen interviews with former NSA contractor Edward Snowden and co-founder of the internet, one of my personal heroes, Mr. Vint Cerf. Digits is definitely something you want to watch if you're on CuriosityStream. You also want to check out Deep Time History, which is an exclusive three-part documentary series that tells the story of the universe's 14 billion-year history in just three parts, including surprising twists to the stories that you thought you knew. So if you're interested in CuriosityStream, they've got monthly and annual plans available, with those annual plans offering a ton of savings. Plans just start at $2.99 per month. That's less than a cup of coffee or the cost of one title on a competing on-demand platform. So check out CuriosityStream at curiositystream.com/twit and use the promo code TWIT during sign-up to get unlimited access to the world's top documentaries and nonfiction series completely free for the first 60 days. That's two entire months free of one of the largest nonfiction 4K libraries around. If you got a 4K TV, you got to be watching CuriosityStream. So go to curiositystream.com/twit and use the offer code TWIT at sign-up, and we thank them for their support.
Thank you, CuriosityStream. All right, we've got a few app stories before we get to the arena. Let's do it. Let's see if I can pull this up. All right, you got this first one, Flo.
You know, I'm really excited about this particular news piece because I don't plan on buying another car for a while, but I want it to be kind of high-techy. So now you can use Android Auto in your car by running it just off your phone, which is awesome, by the way. I used a demo a while ago back at I.O. where it was just hooked up to the car via Bluetooth through the speakers, and it's great. All you got to do is get yourself a cheap little mount, you know, mount the little phone right there so it's you're not holding it in your hand because that is illegal in some states. Actually, most states now that I think of it. But it's great. Look at, here is a demo. Over Jason's shoulders, what we have is the same UI that you would see on regular Android Auto inside of a head unit, inside of a car, except it's on your phone. What do we see here, Jason?
Oh, I thought you were going to talk about it. So yeah, you've got basically your home screen. Obviously, the music controls up at the top here. I mean, anyone who's had Android Auto before has seen some of this interface, but now it's just kind of coming in on your phone. Obviously,
giant icons that are very easy to press that you can just quickly glance at from the corner of your eye.
Big targets.
Yep, you got maps. Can you show us besides Google app? Can you show us another app? Perhaps something from the music realm.
That's okay. So you've got your phone, your call log.
Okay, Pocket Casts.
Right here I've got, because this is the app that I was last using, so it imported Pocket Casts.
Perfect.
The podcast I happen to be listening to. But, you know, any of the music apps that are on here, you can just swatch
it. It's easy. Audible, Google Play Music.
Brave. My kid's favorite song at the moment.
That's adorable.
And, yeah, so, you know, it's just a nice, I don't know, I remember, man, what was it? That Google used to have some sort of an auto interface.
Yeah, I remember.
Years ago.
Yeah, it was like a car mode, essentially.
Yeah, it was terrible. It was so ugly.
It was
so bad.
And it was actually harder to use than using the phone while driving, which is terrible, but yeah, it's the truth.
Yeah, I know. It's just things were bigger,
so,
but not necessarily more usable.
But this is great. It's usable. You can glance at it from a distance. All you need is like a little holster inside your car. If you have an auxiliary hookup, you can just hook it up that way every time you get into the car. If you have Bluetooth, you can set it up for smart lock so that it's, you know, it's always on when you're in the car.
Yeah, it connects to your car Bluetooth, launches the app immediately. A lot of things like that. Also the do not disturb, which is awesome. You don't even know a call came through. Like, you're oblivious to it. And that's how I protect myself when I'm driving. I don't even want to know. I use Agent for that right now to kind of like send an immediate reply
to
somebody.
I need to use that because I'll hear their little Slack chime go off and then I'm like, I'm driving 80. I can't look at it right now.
Oh, I know. Like, I don't even want to know. If I know, I'm going to be more tempted to look at it. And this way they just get a message that says I'm driving. I'll talk to you later. And, it's awesome. So
that's great.
By the way, I don't typically drive 80 miles an hour. I just realized that that's like
everybody in the Bay Area does.
Speed limit.
Yeah, I do.
Sorry, CHP.
Let's see here. I'm a big fan of LastPass. Used them for a few years now for password management. And if that $12 a year was just too much, too rich for your blood, a month.
I've never used LastPass, BT Dubs.
Oh my God, it's a lifesaver.
Yeah,
you awesome. Start, set it up tomorrow, Flo. I just the other day I was thinking, I'm so glad Jason guilted me into using LastPass like 2 years ago because it has saved my butt so many times.
Are you guys
going
to guilt me now?
Yes.
Okay. It's a good guilt.
Because now that it's free, one password right? for the win.
Okay, so why? I'm happy that you said that. What do you love about one password? No, I want to know because I've been curious what the others are like.
Yeah, so I actually started out using LastPass for years, and I was convinced to switch over to 1Password, I think in 2014. And it's because mainly at the time, the Dropbox sync was a little bit more convenient for me than LastPass's kind of proprietary,
right.
And it turns out a little bit less secure form of sync. They've since upgraded. They've, done a whole lot to bring people back. And I don't know if I would have a better, I don't know if I would necessarily have a worse time with LastPass today, but I love 1Password. I don't actually, who cares what password manager you use as long as you use one, right?
And the thing is though, there's 1Pass or 1Password or LastPass or Google's password manager that they've rolled out recently with Chrome,
which I love.
Yeah, so use that. Use a password manager. There's no reason not to be able to either securely store, access, create random, like the control over passwords we have now versus years ago when people would just have 1Password that they used for every account, mm-hmm. Like especially with all the hacks and things like that have happened, like there's no reason not to be using one of these applications and randomizing your passwords, storing them, and then using the app to get in and out of your accounts as you need to. It's seamless.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, they really improved the experience on mobile too, because it used to be doable. There was an app, but you had to do a lot of manual switching between. Now it kind of detects that there's a field there, automatically gives you the overlay with the thing that you tap, maybe authenticate with it, and then boom, everything's imported. So it's a really great thing.
I have
anyways, $12 is now free.
I just have to say my favorite thing about Android at this current state in time or whatever is that I can unlock certain apps with just my fingerprint.
Isn't that nice?
Like password wise.
Mm-hmm. Oh, the
like
fingerprint.
Bank of America. I can just.
Yes.
Boop. It's amazing. And then I get to just see every. Like, I would be totally cool doing that for any app.
And that's the thing. Like LastPass on the app, like I log into LastPass with the fingerprint scan. I don't even need my LastPass password. I just use like
all
I want
right,
fingerprint
I'll check
scan
out LastPass.
Across the board. All right, there you go.
I get it.
We win.
Guilt. The all about Android guilt train.
Well, you know me. I do. Fueled by guilt.
I do. Well, we were talking about VR earlier with Daydream and a little more VR news. Google announced that Chrome for Android will get an update in January that's going to enable web VR support.
Neat.
And this means that Daydream devices will be able to view VR content on the web without the need to jump into a site's official app to do so. All this will come natively from the website through the Chrome browser. Beta program is launching in December, and Gear VR's browser already supports this. So it's more of Daydream getting kind of on the same level playing field as Gear VR and other VR options. Very cool to see web VR support for it because web VR is sweet. So.
Yeah.
Are we really doing this next story?
Oh, yeah, I think we are. I think we have to.
One cute little thing to end on is that y'all remember Neko Itsume I brought into the app arena? last year.
With the little kitty cats.
Little kitty cats. Well, they're making a movie about it.
What on earth would I
just want to quickly tell you the plot line. So you guys remember, you started this with Angry Birds, by the way.
Oh, man.
Now they want to market everything. Okay, yeah. So it's produced and directed by Japanese director Masatoshi Kurokata. Live action version of this stupidly addictive cat game will tell the story of a successful young author with a terrible case of writer's block who moves to the countryside to find inspiration, and I'm assuming ends up just hangs out with a bunch of kitties.
Hmm.
So it
sounds
basically
like a loose
crazy
interpretation.
It's basically a movie about crazy cat people.
Okay.
I mean, isn't there an island of cats in Japan somewhere?
Probably.
There is. I mean,
they can have their own society of just themselves. Like, they'll have their roles, and you know, they'll invent their own printing press. And
another cat island in Japan is Tashirohima Island.
Come up with automobiles.
Yes. With 86 inhabitants and more than 100 cats. On this island, the cat is enshrined.
It's basically a spiritual being, which is amazing.
Wow. Wow. I didn't know that existed.
I'm so mad at my cat right now.
She just wanted to go join the cats in Tashirojima.
She had a higher calling.
Worried about her. Gosh. I'm just watching this, and I'm like, God, cats are so mean.
They can be mean.
That's why I'm getting a puppy in 4 days.
Oh, wow. Congratulations. That's the way I'd go, too. Someday I'll get a puppy. Hey, we have a video mail. Thank you. We love our video mail. We actually have a few stockpiled, so we'll be playing it for the next few weeks. James Thatcher. Has this message. He's a big fan of the show. James, what you got?
Hey, all about Android crew. It's Big Jim.
And Sam Thatcher.
And we're here to ask a quick question. We know the holiday season's coming up, and we would like to know, sub $200, what is a good tablet we can get for mommy? She's not very tech savvy, but, you know, I know the first inkling is going to be
a rock and roll tablet.
Okay. The first inkling is to go with an Amazon Kindle or Kindle HD. But I just was curious, is there other options that you guys think that are good out there for the sub $200 market? Thanks.
Say bye. Oh, bye.
Yep, he had more to say, but no,
thank
we're not.
I like Sam. That was adorable.
I like Sam. Awesome. I want to hear about rock and roll hardware. Yeah, I like
rock and roll tablet would be a really good tablet, I think.
It's funny that he sent this in, because just the other day as I was plugging in my Nexus 9 to charge, I quickly got sad because I was like, oh, I wonder how much longer my Nexus 9 is going to work. And then I wondered, what tablet would I get from now? And I actually had the same thought. Like, is Kindle Fire tablets really the only tablets that are out there now, or – Well, like, is this a dying space?
There are other tablets, but I mean, the Kindle Fire is, you know, in the sub $200 brand. Like, there really aren't a whole lot that are kind of light and.
And I have to tell you, I don't agree with one of your suggestions that you have.
I'm not saying that these are suggestions. Okay. I was just trying to find options. Right. I was like, they're really like, I think probably near the, if not the top of the list, would be the Amazon Fire, only because for that price in that category, you actually get a lot. Like, you not only get the tablet, you get a lot of, like, extra support from Amazon,
which is very reputable. They're very reputable, obviously. Yeah. I mean, because you had here in our notes the Lenovo Yogo Tab 3, which I just want to tell you, James, please don't. Lenovo's UI on this tablet series is abysmal, and it will turn your wife off from Android. Okay.
But it's got a kickstand.
I don't even care. Just put it up against a wall if that's such a Don't give her something that'll make her not like Android.
Well, it's funny because the other option that Jason has here for us to suggest was the one that I've been suggesting to people, which is the NVIDIA Shield tablet, which I feel like is like cannot get any notoriety or respect.
I can't get no respect.
Rodney Dangerfield. Yeah, thanks, Rodney. Didn't expect that from the millennial. Everyone I know with an NVIDIA Shield loves it, like, and recommends it and has no problems with it and swears by it. So I think the NVIDIA Shield is a good option as well, too.
Yeah.
Or Galaxy Tab A, if you really want to go.
Okay, no.
No?
No.
No. Dan says
that's
no.
That's a little bit more. That's not sub 200. Yeah,
that's 300 and Dan says no. Ooh.
Why you say no?
All right, here's a crazy suggestion.
Go on.
Get a Chromebook.
Wow.
That's not a crazy suggestion at all. Which Chromebook?
Because, okay, the Chromebook Flip, the Asus Chromebook Flip, it's right. About $200. It is currently, it supports Android apps. Mm-hmm. It's not the greatest tablet if you use it as one, but it's a hell of a lot more versatile than most Android tablets. And it runs both Android apps natively and Chrome apps. And honestly, I think that's the way to go. That's a shout out to Jerry Hildenbrand, our awesome Chromebook editor on Android Central. He made this recommendation because we were talking about this exact thing today for our holiday gift guide. And I'm like, I'm all in on Android. I'm like, Android phones are where it's at. The Pixel's a great phone. But if you're buying a tablet, I'd actually recommend an iPad to most people because there's nothing in the Android space that interests me right now.
And it kills me because this whole product category just seems like it's dying on the vine.
What about the Galaxy Tab S too? It's such a good tablet.
Yeah, it's going to blow bucks. Up. It's going to blow also, up, probably.
Yes, but I thought Dan meant in its entirety.
I did. I mean, in general, I don't recommend Android tablets because apps are just not optimized for them, especially
that's
big
fair.
Like 10-inch tablets. If you're going to go for something, get like the, so I went to this holiday gift thing from Huawei and they were showing off the new MediaPad 8, M3. Mm-hmm. It's a $400 tablet. I mean, it's an 8-inch tablet. It's beautiful. It's nicely made. It's metal, got dual speakers, got super, lots of power, great screen, but it's a $400 tablet. I mean, you're talking about like two or three legitimate options under $200 in the Android tablet space right now. A couple of years ago, when we had the Nexus 7, at $200, that was an amazing choice.
So amazing.
But now we're picking at scraps. It's crazy.
It's nothing but scraps.
And honestly, as a Chromebook user, having played with Android apps on a touchscreen Chromebook, now that you can do that, I mean, I'm really happy you brought that up because I didn't even consider that as the answer to this. That extends the usability, but still gives you most of the things that you would want a tablet for anyways, most of those, tablet apps, there are some tablet apps that won't run on a Pixel because the Pixel the Chromebook lacks certain pieces of hardware to allow for it. But most of the things that you might possibly use it for are going to be supported. Media playback, definitely, if that's, part of it. And then you also happen to get, a keyboard, computer.
And it makes it a lot easier to stand up on the toilet when you're taking a bath and you want to watch TV, you just stand it
legitimate
up.
Use case just right there.
Oh wait, you're standing the tablet up on the toilet. Well, you're not standing on the toilet.
No. You put
that's
the
me,
toilet
Ron.
Seat down, put the tablet or the Chromebook on top with the
I was really lost for like 20 seconds there. I didn't know what you were talking about.
Dim the lights. You get you.
I don't know how you guys work at Android Central, but it sounds weird. That's all.
What was that infuser again?
This is what I do on work trips. I'm like, I've had a long day. You guys go out and get a drink. I'm going to watch Hulu.
She's basically calling me a terrible manager, by the way. This is her way of digging into me right now.
No. This is how I use my laptop. Because you can't, I don't have a tablet stand.
Uh-huh. See, tablet stands are
and
important.
And the laptop goes louder than the tablet.
Yeah, but I will... Yeah, I will tell you that the tablet as a product, for me, it's the one killer app is at the gym on the treadmill or the elliptical, just being able to pop the tablet up on there. And laptops can't do that. I know with the flippy kind of one, the Chromebook ones and stuff like that, you get a better chance. But there's something to having a really slim, thin thing that you can prop up against something. I love my Nexus 9.
Why don't you just get a big phone, Ron? This works perfectly. I watch so much reality TV on this at the gym.
But my tablet is so much bigger than that.
I know. You'll hurt your eyes. Don't watch it so close.
Yeah. All right. I hope we answered your question, James. And thanks for sending your video. And everybody else, send in your videos too, because we love getting video mail. It's time to go just lightly. We've got possibly the most important vote ever in the history of this show on tonight's arena.
So many enter, but only one lives. Android Arena.
All right, so last week's vote, bit.ly/AAA vote 290.
Oh, my God.
Oh?
Look at my rank. I'm so bad this week.
Oh,
I'm back.
No, you're not back.
I'm knocking on the door.
You're knocking on the door, though, which is you're knocking on the gate.
Let's see the results there, Jason. Let's go over the results.
Knocking on even door. Ron wins slightly. Man, we were super close. This is a really close one. Pin Out gets 41%. Never in a million years did I think Solitaire Decked Out would almost
so good.
It's a good app.
It's a great Solitaire game.
It's a great Solitaire app.
But it's Solitaire. But
I'm
happy. I
think we all have to pay Android Police a debt of thanks for making that known to all of us. I think we all found it through that article.
Yeah, now it's like one of the top apps.
Crazy.
It's pretty awesome. It's pretty awesome. So Solitaire Decked Out, close second at 39%. No, is it Nami or Nomi? 12%. And Triominoes at 8%. So Team Guest, last place. That hasn't happened very much this year.
It hasn't happened. And Wade County's in the chat room, and he checks in with the stats as we're through 45 weeks on the year. So just 7 weeks to go, guys. Team Guest is currently still in first with 14. Jason is in second. He pulled ahead to second. With 11 wins, Flo's in third with 10, and I'm bringing up the route 9, just knocking on the door,
Okay, so that means, Flo, you are first.
Well, I actually, my app pick this week is thanks to a Twitter follower whose name escapes me at the moment. But just know I saw your tweet and I really appreciate it. And I believe I did reply and I brought it into the arena this week. My app is Gnaro, which I realize sounds silly, but let me tell you, this is kind of interesting if you spend a lot of time in the car and maybe you want to catch up on, you know, what you've got living in your pocket feed or what you've got, you know, maybe you've got a bookmarks folder of stuff that you want to read. So the way it works is it turns articles that you bookmark into listenable, like, audiobooks, essentially. And what this app does is you install it and it lives in the back end. And so when you use it from like the Chrome mobile, for instance, it will archive those words and put it into an XML feed that you can feed into Pocket Casts and listen to. Nice. So allow me to demonstrate how this works. As you can see, my notifications are filling up because everyone's texting me about the election right now.
Don't look at it.
I know. I'm trying really hard. I'm like, I really want to read them, but I'm not going to. So hopefully you don't see anything. But okay. So yes, Yoga Glow. It's fine. You can see that. Let's go to Android Central.
Hi.
My employer. Let's go
to
the article I wrote on Snapchat today. Now we're going to share this to Gnaro, which I keep wanting to say Natto, which is the sticky, it's like this sticky stuff on there. Ah, there's a number. Okay, hold on. Where are you? Add to Gnaro. Adding to Gnaro. Yay, this reading has been added to your Gnaro feed. Now, it's worth noting that sometimes this won't work. Like, it doesn't work with New York Times articles, and I think it's because of I think it's just because of the way the layout is on the page. I'm not entirely sure what it is. I'm just making guesses here. Okay, so that's stored in Gnaro. La, 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 la. Oh, you can all see my keep.
Here you go.
All right. Well, I was listening to my 90210 podcast earlier today.
I know. That's how you roll.
Whatever. At least it's interesting. Okay.
I was going to say, like, what is name up to right now, but I have no idea.
Don't do it.
Jason Priestley, he was on an episode a couple of weeks ago. So the only issue with Gnaro, and I think I should have queued something up before the show. So it's going to actually take a little bit before it shows up on
it needs to cash into it or something.
Which I'm a little, now I'm a little embarrassed.
Refresh into it.
Because the articles that I have on here are not very podcast friendly. We'll do this article that I pinned yesterday. It's Jennifer Aniston talking about how she doesn't know what she's doing. So we'll just play that.
Getting a glimpse into your podcast listening history. It has something to do with 90210 or Jennifer Aniston, so possibly Friends.
Hold on.
Is it not?
Can you Can you take that off?
Is this case too good?
It's the spec case. It like really, yeah.
I'm afraid I have long nails
and they're going to break.
I'm afraid I'm going to break your phone.
Please don't, because I actually
paid I'm trying not to.
It's not reviewing it.
Break the case over the phone, I think.
Dear man, that is.
All right.
While we're waiting, let's all talk about the live cases from Google and how awesome they are.
Are they good? I've heard
mixed. But they're like $40.
I just got mine. I got mine yesterday. I was at a cottage over Canadian Thanksgiving, and I took this long exposure shot that was like my favorite of the stars, and it turned out super well. And I was like, yes, that's the one. You know, I don't need no astronaut shots. I got my own. Even though Chris Hadfield's photography is amazing, and it turns out really well. I mean, it's a little low res. It's you know, super, super high res, but I think it turned out great and it looks awesome on my Pixel XL. So it could be $10 less though.
Yeah, sure. I know they are a little expensive, but they can look sharp. I like the Maps ones.
How are you doing there, Flo?
I think we have something, but don't break your phone.
Oh, God.
This is just a little too tight for me.
What inspires me deep in my car? What used to make me tick is not necessarily making me tick anymore. The most challenging thing right now is trying to find weapons.
So this is in Pocket
Cast. Can you guys hear that?
So this is the article read to you in podcast form. Justin
Theroux. Yeah, look how nice her voice is.
Feel completely safe. Yeah, Jennifer sounds good for...
In no matter what state, but while she relishes her thriving relationship, she does not shy away from critiquing
it's not bad Texas
speech. So while Jennifer Aniston relishes in her thriving relationship, so I actually tried it against the dictation engine in Pocket, the app Pocket, and Pocket just uses the Google, the standard Google, which sounds, you know, it's very robot-y. So I like it. It's kind of neat. And, you know, I can listen to Jezebel while I'm driving.
It's funny because I was looking at this app and then I ultimately decided not to bring it to the arena a couple months ago, and I can't remember what turned me off.
You're right, guys. Ron got to it before I did.
Well, no. I'm just saying no, because I thought it was really interesting, because I thought the taking articles and doing text to speech was not new, but creating a podcast feed for it was really interesting. But there was something about, and I can't remember what it was, but I was like, I'm not gonna bring it though. So I'm glad you did though, because maybe it's gotten better or changed, but I don't know what the thing was that turned me off. So
yeah, I tried it with just a couple different articles. Like I said, doesn't work particularly well with like New York Times and Wall Street Journal articles, WSJ, because they have a harsher paywall, understandably so. Please pay for journalism. But you know, for, you know, more casual stuff on the internet, maybe you want to get your celebrity gossip into a feed, go do that.
It's cool. I really like that. Like I bookmark, you know, articles for later reading. This is basically bookmarking articles for later podcast listening.
It's a little weird. Like if you're doing like a big article has been compiled of like different, you know, news briefs, then it's going to read them all and you're going to be like, where am I? But, it's right now it's kind of a novelty, but I could see it like getting, like Google Home, I could see it getting better over time.
You just want the best for all of the technology.
My thing is just make it amazing now, or why bother?
Because sometimes you can't get there right away.
I know.
All right. Let's see here. So I'm going to need the audio back. I got that right down here.
It's all yours, It's all yours.
Mine is a game. And I don't know if you guys remember, was it Surgeon Simulator? Way back when.
Oh, yes. That was a creepy game in all of its...
Okay. Okay, so mine, this is made by the same people who made Surgeon Simulator, and it is called I Am Bread.
Oh, dear.
And basically, you guess it and guess what you are. You're a piece of bread, and you have different environments in which that you are bread, essentially. You're trying to get across from one point of the environment to another. So let's see here. So I'm going to go ahead and be bread. We're going to start in the kitchen.
Can you pick your type?
No, I don't believe so. You're just a piece of bread. All right, so here we are. I'm going to go ahead and launch into the kitchen here. Now, I know you guys have always wanted to be a piece of bread. That's what this is all about.
It's about finally getting the chance to live your life as a piece of bread. So you become toast. That's the goal. There's a toaster across the room. You got to get there, but you've got all this space with which to do it. So there's different, you know, methods and everything. You kind of walk around. Now the whole thing where, you know, you drop food on the ground and you have the, like, the 10-second rule, that applies here because you want to get to the other side and be totally edible. And so if you end up here, let me
wait 10 seconds. I thought it was 5 seconds
or whatever it is. I think it's more than that.
I think they altered it. I think they came to their senses.
Yeah. I mean, seriously, what's
I think it's an 8-second rule.
What's a few more
seconds? Is the bread alive in this? How is the bread moving?
Okay, so I'm on the ground. Now you see my edibility is going down. So I better get to the wall really quick. And I
You can't get up that wall.
Oh, I can't.
How are you doing that?
Yeah, how are you doing that? You're a piece of bread. Do you have jelly on you?
I'm just magic. I'm so mad. I'm magical bread. It's really hard to do this without lights in the studio. And apparently I'm trapped on the chair. Okay, get up to the... this is really hard to do.
It's like Spider-Man bread. It's like Spider-Man bread. Okay, this is amazing.
So I made it up there so I can look around, plan my next. And so basically you can climb up the walls, you can launch off things. You've got different moves. Like if I need to hop a little bit, I can just tap
can
right here.
Can you butter
here.
Yourself?
No, not that I've seen. Although I'd be really surprised if you couldn't. I could put myself on this plate if I wanted to.
Eat me.
I could climb up this game of Jenga, maybe. I think that's what that is.
I see someone's planning a game night.
Uh-oh.
Oh, no, that's a knife block.
Uh-oh. I better get to the refrigerator. My edibility, I'm not going to be delicious. Oh, man. It's really hard to play this sideways, but eventually you get to the toaster, and you find your way into the toaster, and you become delicious, and you pass the
I am
level.
Dead.
Not eating that.
I love how you have Google Play Games achievements in this game around toast. It's great.
I know.
I love Google Play Game achievements. It makes me keep playing games, not going to lie.
I am not toast. Not this time. It says down at the bottom, F, I am not eating that. Because I'm delicious. I'm not delicious. I've been on the floor
too
long.
You're way too germy.
Yes. Anyways, it's a silly game. It's $4.99, so it's a little expensive, but it is a lot of fun, and it's got a lot of levels, and it's designed really well, and it's a little bit easier than I demonstrated because it's really hard sometimes to play these games and talk about them and do it sideways and stuff. But yeah, it's called, it is Jenga, see?
Oh, it is Jenga. Who just has Jenga set up in their kitchen?
This is particular some kitchen. Don't fall in the trash can. Oh, man. Your edibility rating is going to go through
Why
the floor.
Why is there bread in the bathroom?
Stay away from that toilet. Oh, jeez.
I needed to use the chair to get up. Oh my God.
The bread looks like it's alive and it's creeping me out.
I'll never
really
look at bread
creepy.
The same way again.
Oh, no. Something stuck to it.
I picked up some gum.
Yeah, that's bad. Anyways, it's a lot of fun. It's called I Am Bread.
It's Check. Driving a lawnmower. What's happening?
It's yeah.
Oh.
Hey, enjoy. Jason, can I go next? Can I request to go next?
Okay.
Yeah, cool. Because my girlfriend's getting back from a business trip any minute. I'm afraid the dog will freak out. So let me get mine done. So, yeah. So, and then Daniel can go after me. Real quickly, I was looking for a fun, different app to bring to the arena. And I was like, it's been a while since I've done a keyboard. And so I searched it and I found out that the company Baidu out of China released a keyboard called Talk Type Voice Keyboard. And they claim it's the world's first voice-centric keyboard for Android. And so basically what that means is that when you go through the enabling all the permissions like Jason's doing right now and enabling it as your input device, when you go to use it, there's a little test screen. You'll notice that the first option is speech. You don't get a keyboard in this. You tap the keyboard and you talk to it. So, Jason, why don't you test it out? Just say anything or just, you know, go from there.
I'm just going to say a few words, keyboard.
And you see that it's detecting what there you go. Yep, yeah. There it goes. So it's detecting what he's saying as he's talking. The voice detection is really strong and is really, really quite good from what I've seen. But they make it really easy to edit if you see anything incorrectly. So if you just tap on a word, tap on detected, you'll get suggestions. And then you could also switch over to the keyboard down if you hit ABC down on the bottom.
and you can switch to the keyboard and make any corrections that you might need to be. But when I was testing it earlier today, the only corrections I needed to make, it automatically detected. So if it detected a word incorrectly and I tapped on it, it suggested the correct wording, or, you know, I said me too, and it didn't pick that up, but then the suggestions picked that up as well. So apparently a lot of Baidu's research has gone into making this pretty solid. And in addition to voice commands, it also has, as you see there, you hit the little button there and you can do the GIF keyboard. So you can, bring in GIFs from Giphy, as everybody loves. We all like the GIFs, you know, that's important to have. But you can also bring in restaurants, search results from Yelp are embedded in there directly, which is pretty cool. And of course, you have the standard keyboard that uses swipe capability. So if you hit the letters there, you can swipe in the keys and all that sort of thing. So it was a really well done, strong keyboard that it has a different way of interfacing, and in that it's primarily voice. So if you want to, you know, if you're out of your house after using your Google Home and you want to keep on talking to your phone, talk type voice keyboard could be the way to go to keep the talking to your device love flowing. So yeah, pretty strong. So check that out. It's free in the Google Play Store. Interesting to see Baidu coming up with apps that kind of remind me of Microsoft and their little experiments. So this is a good one. Cool. So talk type voice keyboard.
There talk type voice keyboard.
Cool.
Excellent. Talk type voice keyboard. Kind of hard to say. All right. Yeah. Daniel, I have yours installed. I'll show it off while you talk about it.
Okay. Oh. So I was going to choose pin out, and I was going to win this week.
It's true.
But now I'm just resigned to telling you all about a really good productivity app that you're probably not going to vote for, but you should definitely install it and it'll change your life. So this is Newton, and Newton used to be called Cloud Magic. And if you remember a few years ago, Cloud Magic made a big splash as this multi-platform email disruptor. It was supposed to consolidate a whole bunch of different things together. Initially, the company was an aggregator for all of your cloud accounts like Dropbox and Office and what's OneDrive and all the other ones. And they decided that instead of focusing on that, they should use their amazing search to just focus on making a really great email app. So they rebranded to Newton and they launched a subscription model. So it's $50 a year, and that's a lot of money, I know, but it is by far the best email service I've ever used. It's better than Gmail on Android. And I say that knowing wow. how good Gmail on Android is. Hmm. It's the search is incredible. It's multi-platform, so it has apps on Windows, Mac, iOS, and Android. They're all in current development and they all work super fast. And because I have a lot of different devices, all of your settings, including your aliases, your signatures, and your search history, syncs across devices in real time, which makes it amazing if you use multiple devices like I do. So all you have to do is log into your app to the account, and all of your stuff is saved. It's not like when you start up a new Android phone, you have to log into your account separately, all that good stuff. It even has a really good calendar. Thank you for reminding me. And it has these things called superchargers. And those are things like read receipts. Because now let me just be clear about this. They don't store your emails on their server. All they do is they store a little bit of metadata to allow them to tell you across platforms that you are that their supercharger services like read receipts have gone into effect. So that's my spiel on Newton. It has changed my life. They have not paid me, I promise you. Mm-hmm. I'm just saying that after starting using Newton on Mac and Android, I actually enjoy email again, and I hate email. So wow. It's worth it. It's a 2-week free trial, and it's $50 a year after that. And for something that you use every day and usually people hate, I think it's worth the money.
Yeah, no kidding.
So there you go. That's Newton.
All right, nice.
Cool.
I had not heard
that's
of
worth that. Checking out for sure. Yeah.
I mean, when I was
I remember Cloud Magic, but I didn't realize it had gone so far. So
when I was
yeah, they're great, and because now they're subscription based, there's no You know, there's no question of them going, you know, down the mailbox rabbit hole and getting bought out and getting shut down, or just, you know, fading away to nothing. They're forming a sustainable, if smaller, business. And I think that's very noble. So, yeah.
When I was setting it up just right now, scrambling through like the list of supported accounts that came up, I was like, like it's so many.
Yeah, yeah, it's a lot. And a lot of that's the other thing, is that it's not just Gmail. It's every possible email account you want.
Nice. That's awesome. It's Newton. So you can place your vote for your favorite app this week. Is it Naro? Is it I Am Bread? Talk Type Voice Keyboard? Or Newton? Go to bit.ly/AAAVote291. bit.ly/AAAVote291. I had the URL wrong last week for like a day, so I apologize about that. This one works.
No wonder I lost.
Yeah, that was it.
Just kidding.
That was it. Fraud. Yep. bit.ly/AAAVote291 to place your vote, and we'll check in on that next week.
Ryan, did you vote for bread?
I know. Who doesn't like bread? Seriously. I understand.
After this show, Brian.
Why I have to vote with my heart.
That is it for this week. Daniel Bader, great to have you on again. It's been too long. Really appreciate you taking time out on such a monumental evening tonight.
Yes.
I'm already drained about the things outside of this show. This show is the gleaming light of this evening, I think.
It's the only reason to like America right now, let's be honest.
That's for sure.
So,
thank you so much for having me, really. And I have a spare bedroom if anybody needs to crash here for a day, a week, a month, or 4 years.
Tomorrow I'm going to knock at Daniel's door.
Daniel needs friends.
Daniel, I'm leaving now. I'm getting in a car.
Ron's closer than me. That's the problem.
Appreciate it, man. So AndroidCentral.com, is there anything you're working on right now you want people to know?
Well, I don't know if everybody's been following, but we put together a really kick-ass smartphone buyer's guide.
We did.
Covering a whole bunch of different stuff. Flo worked her butt off to get that finished. And we, I think, have the best smartphone buyer's guide on the internet.
I agree.
Right now. So if you go to AndroidCentral.com/smartphone, or just search smartphone buyer's guide. It'll come up as like the number one choice because it's the best. And actually, I shouldn't say that. I don't want to jinx myself. But smartphone buyer's guide, Android Central will get you there. And it's pretty fantastic. So,
awesome.
I feel like now, though, I should write a best tablet under $200.
That would yeah. That'd be a good entry. It might be kind of hard to write, though.
There is nothing. There is no hope.
There really isn't very much out there. Thank you.
There is no hope.
Goodbye. At Journey Dan on Twitter as well. Thank you again, Daniel. Appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
Flo, what about you, other than the buyer's guide?
Well, Daniel's my editor, so this is awkward. he gives you my assignments. So, but if you want, you can tweet at me at OThatFlo. Follow me on Snapchat, also at OThatFlo. And this week, I will set up Google Home. I promise I will. And I will see what it can do.
Hopefully I can figure out
how to order some darn food through this thing. All I want to do is be able to order some food without touching any device. That's all
it's
I
coming.
Want to do.
It's coming.
I don't
coming.
Care if it's pizza. I don't care if it's Chinese food. I don't care the cuisine. I just want food to arrive at my door, have the transaction happen without any touching of a device.
And it,
I just want to go.
That's the
use
dream.
Use that credit card. Here's my address. Add a tip. That's always tip your pizza delivery person,
it's
by
true.
The way.
It's true. It's a good life tip there. Yeah, coming soon. You'll get it.
Also,
you'll
I can't wait to buy a new base for mine, because let me tell you, I'm eyeing that purple one. Girl.
Ron, what is the color of your base?
Well, currently it's beige, but I'm hopeful about updating mine as well, too. We'll see about that. But in the meantime, you can go follow me at Twitter. I'm at RonXO, and you go to about.me/RonXO. You can find all the links to all my other fun stuff. And I'm just going to stop there, because if I talk anymore, I'm going to start weeping. So
don't weep. oh, no. Now I'm scared. Brian, what about you?
Well, let's see. What do I? Oh yeah, Know How this week. We're working on beer. We'll show you how to do it yourself, and I also do a brewery tour, which was a lot of fun. And then this week on Screensavers will be my review of the PS4 Pro. Is it worth it? Find out on Saturday.
tune in Saturday.
Which brewery did you guys go to? Can you tease?
I went to Third Street Ale Works in Santa Rosa. I don't know if you've ever heard of it. It's yes, one of I my have. Favorites.
I have lived here all my life. Thank you.
Well, it seems like most people, when they go to Santa Rosa, they go to Russian River, which
That's
is an
fair.
Excellent brewery.
That's
a good one. That's a good one.
It's true.
It is yummy. You can find me at about.me/JasonHowell. Follow my music at yellowgoldmusic.com. I promise someday I'll have something new up there for you. And as for this show, that's it. Finito. Finished.
But Leave not us, forever.
Well, until next week. And we're always around on the internet. So, you know, hit us up. Voicemail 347-SHOW-AAA. You can find us on Twitter, or sorry, email, video mail at AAA@twit.tv. Twitter, we are at Android Show. We have a subreddit, which is twitaaa.reddit.com. Helps inform us of stories that you care about. Show notes and past episodes at twit.tv/AAA, of course. You can also find our episodes on YouTube, iTunes, Pocket Cast, all over the map. Rick, oh, and Google Home.
And Google Home.
I imagine.
Don't forget.
And Every Lie, every Tuesday, 5:30 p.m. Pacific at twit.tv/live. That's it. We'll see y'all next week. Bye.
Sorry, I threw you off, Jason.
It's okay.
I was trying to promote
but
us.
But it's true.